All right. I'm going to try to summarize what we were discussing about this simple example of generative models using Gaussian distributions. And then I think where we stopped was to do the maximum likelihood estimation. Okay, so let me go fast through this just to remind you what we were doing. So basically, the model is generative because to produce this distribution, so to be able to assign X to different classes, we use Bayes' rule that requires that we know the class conditional distributions. We need to know how the data are generated for each class. All right? So writing Bayes' rule, we have this nice equation, the normalizing factor on the bottom, and then what we did is we simplified the equation by some magic, by defining this ratio to be A, all right? And then, so A is the log of these two things here. And then by a miracle, this P of C1 given X came to be a sigmoid function of A, okay? So in some sense, looks exactly like the logistic regression model. The only difference is that to go from here to there, we still use this class conditional distribution, so we did not arbitrarily put this as the model, okay? But it looks like the logistic regression model at this point. Okay, I remind you, because I'm actually going to use this again today, that a good approximation of the logistic regression function that you see here from 0 to 1 is to use what is called this inverse probit function. It's actually a scaled inverse probit function because you see a lambda there. There is some scaling, and that lambda is square root of pi over 8. So the approximation looks very nice. And this inverse probit function always is used to approximate the sigmoid function, especially when you do convolutions of the sigmoid function with a Gaussian. So later today, we hopefully we reach that point where you will see some convolution of the sigmoid function with a Gaussian. So in that case, the only way to do this analytically would be to use this approximation. And as you notice, the approximation looks extremely good. All right, we have done all of this. And we also said that if we have many classes, we just have to redefine what those coefficients alpha are. And in my case, I'm going to take the alpha to be log of P of X given CK times the prior of CK. And then what we get is we get this softmax function that does the same role as the sigmoid. It basically produces probabilities from 0 to 1. And it is called softmax because you can see that this, if alpha k is much greater than all the other alpha j's, then this approximates 1, otherwise it's 0. So this function is called the softmax. And it's a function that comes everywhere, all right? So it's not something you see in this lecture and you forget tomorrow, because this this representation that you see here is fundamental, and not only to classification problems. Okay, so going back to two classes, we assumed that the class conditional distributions were Gaussians, and we took the same covariance sigma, because we said if we take the same covariance sigma, the quadratic terms that we see here, X transpose sigma inverse X, cancel out, okay? So when you use this definition of A, okay, and you remember there's a log there, so there will be a log of this and the coefficient in the exponential. So when you compute A, you only get a linear term in X that you see here, plus a constant, the bias term, and the prior probabilities come only in the bias term. The quadratic terms have been canceled because you can see here X transpose sigma inverse X, right? And then you see minus, and then you see plus X transpose sigma inverse X. If the sigmas were not the same, you will actually have quadratic terms, okay? So we don't have that. All right, and so here's the example that we saw last week. So the class conditional probabilities, they are these nice Gaussians. And the assignments are done based on these probabilities that you see here, okay? And so if you have something like that, right? Obviously, you can see if you set a threshold of 0.5, let's say greater than 0.5 to be class 1 and less than 0.5 to be class 2, this sigmoid being 0.5 means W transpose X plus W0 is equal to 0. So the separating boundaries are basically hyperplanes, right? So that's very nice. Okay. And we, you know, the same thing happens with many classes. And the only thing that you pay attention when you read the in details the notes, the way that I introduce alpha k, it has a quadratic term on it. But you notice this quadratic term shows up in the numerator and the denominator, so things eventually cancel out. So even though I call this to be alpha k, on the next slide, I have redefined what alpha k is to keep only the linear terms because the quadratic terms cancel out. I did not want to use another notation, right? So I call this alpha k, but I'm just saying be aware that alpha k has a quadratic term, but e to this term there, right, and e to the same term on the denominator, they will all disappear. Okay? So effectively, you can see you are getting the softmax function where alpha k is equal to wk transpose x plus some bias term. So you can do multi-class classification with no problem. Okay, and we saw this example, and I think that's where we stopped, right? So in this case, you have three classes, and you can see two of these classes obviously have the same covariance. That's why the separating boundary here is a plane. The other, you know, class has a different covariance, and that's why you see quadratic boundaries, right? That comes from the X transpose X terms. Okay, so now the question is, right, that's where we need to start moving on. The class conditional distributions have means, have this variance, and then you have these prior probabilities that I call them here pi and 1 minus pi. So the question is, how do you compute the mean of these conditional distributions, and how do you compute the covariance, and I'm going to do the example having the same covariance for two classes. So we're going to use maximum likelihood, and so we're going to assume that I give you some points xn, and I give you the class labels that can be 0 or 1, right? So I give you some points, and I tell you this is class 1, this is class 2, etc., defined by these labels tn, that is 1 and 0, okay? So we have to do maximum likelihood, so we have to compute what the likelihood looks like. All right, pay attention to the way the calculations are done, because literally the idea is universal. You can do the same thing in much more complex cases. So if I compute the joint probability of xn and the class label being C1, right, I can write this. P of xn given that xn is in class 1 times the prior of class 1. So this joint probability is pi, right, this prior, times the Gaussian corresponding to class 1. You see that? I mean, I could not write that the likelihood is this Gaussian because that's not enough information. To be in that Gaussian, to have that likelihood, first you have to be in that Gaussian. Right, because there are two Gaussians here. There are two classes. So first you have to be in class 1, and the probability of being in class 1 is pi, and then once you are there, the probability of xn is given by that Gaussian. That's why that's the joint distribution. Okay, now I can do the same thing for the joint of xn and c2. So the prior here is 1 minus pi, and I have the second Gaussian. And so if I give you n data points, I am going to write the likelihood in this wonderful form. So I want you to look carefully and tell me that you're happy with it, that makes sense to you. Remember the labels Tn for my training points are either 1 or 0. So look at that equation for each point and tell me if it makes sense. So for each point, I claim that the likelihood is this to the power tn times this to the power 1 minus tn. Does that make sense? Why it makes sense on a Friday? Right, so if it happens that tn is 1, right, then you get this, which is nice. If it happens that tn is 0, you only get this term, which is nice. All right? So this is a compact way to write the likelihood without saying, oh, for those points in class 1, do this. For those points in class 2, do that. No. You already have the labels. You don't really need to explicitly say if t1 is equal to 1 or 0. Whatever it is, this formula does the job. Okay. So now we have the likelihood. We're going to work with log likelihood because it's easier, obviously. And so this, I want you to, I don't see the equation with the log likelihood, but you can immediately imagine this product will become a summation, tn will come down, and then you will get log of this, all right? And log of that would be log of pi and, log of this Gaussian, and the same thing up there. So I want to maximize the log likelihood, all right? So the unknowns are pi, all right? Mu 1, mu 2, and sigma. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take derivatives with respect to each unknown one at a time. So I'm gonna start with the derivatives of the log likelihood with respect to pi. Will you agree the only terms that involve pi will be tn times log of pi and 1 minus tn log of 1 minus pi? Everybody agrees? All right. So you take derivatives with respect to pi, all right? So you're going to have inside the summation here 1 over pi and 1 over 1 minus pi with a minus sign there. And if you put things together, the answer comes that pi is equal to the sum of tn divided by n. So does that answer make sense to you? Is this what you expect? So what is the sum of tn will give you? The number of points, the training points in class 1, all right? And remember, pi is the prior that you will be in class 1, so this is sort of the empirical mean. How many points out of the n points I had in class 1, and that's exactly what you get. Okay, so, lots of times, all right, in these settings you get the obvious answer. In other settings maybe more complex, but at least here you don't even have to do the algebra. Now, by the way, I am not going to do all the algebra, but you may ask, you notice here, because I have two classes, I put the priors pi and 1 minus pi. This would be a little bit more complicated if I have k classes. So what I have done on the next slide, I repeat this calculation to compute the MLE estimate of pi, of pi k, when I have capital K classes. All right? So I want to highlight what is different from two classes, because again, the formalism is very generic, okay? Two things. Maybe for right or wrong reason, instead of x, n, I put phi n, because I can use some future of x, right? So that, don't be bothered by that. So the only thing that you see here new in writing the likelihood is there is a product. So this is the same as before, but to a power tnk. So what does tnk means here? So I have training point n. So when is tnk equal to 1? When point n is in what class? In the k class, right? Before I only had tn because it was either 1 or 0. I had two classes, but now I have capital K classes, right? So, and because I put this product there, I need to use tnk. And the other thing that you notice here is I need to have a prior for each class. I cannot put pi and 1 minus pi. I can put pi 1, pi 2, pi k. But now the sum of all of these pi k's has to be equal to 1, right? Because I need to be the sum of these probabilities has to be equal to 1. Okay, So I am not going to do the algebra. I want you to, when you go home, to actually read this slide, because what you see in this slide comes everywhere. So let me only say the following. You will still take the log likelihood, the two products become summations, and if you concentrate only in computing pi k, all right, you can immediately see where the pi k contribution comes, okay? Mainly comes here, but to be able to optimize with respect to each of the pi's, you're going to have to use Lagrange multipliers, because these coefficients, these prior probabilities pi k, they're not independent of each other. So you will not be able to just take derivative with respect to pi k, set it equal to zero, and say that's the answer. You have to enforce this with a Lagrange multiplier. So when you optimize this with respect to pi k, you have to enforce this constraint equal to one. So you have to compute the Lagrange multiplier for that. And then, of course, you have to optimize with respect to pi k. And the algebra, I give it to you here in this one line. You should be able to follow it. There is nothing magic. If you have a problem, email me. The final answer is given that pi k is nk divided by n, where nk is the number of points in class k. Again, the obvious answer. All right, so nothing fancy. Okay, the second thing is we need to optimize with respect to each of the means. So let's concentrate to one of the means. So, you know, when you take logs here, right, you're going to have Tn of the log of this Gaussian, and you keep only the terms where the mean comes. So effectively, you will have to, this is the only term where mu1 comes. All right, this is the only term where the mu1 comes. And when you take derivatives with respect to mu1, the answer comes to be equal to this wonderful result. By the way, I'm assuming, you know, taking derivatives with respect to vectors and matrices, it's something that you need to learn. And there is an appendix in Bishop's book, a one-page appendix, that gives you the general rules for taking derivatives with respect to vectors and matrices. So I'm not going to review those, but if you use common sense and you take derivatives with respect to mu1, this is the answer. And I want you to look at this answer and tell me if it makes sense to you. Read me that answer. What does it say? Mu1 equal to what's on the right-hand side? Because the answer has to be the common sense answer again. So what's mu1? Exactly, because all of these terms are non-zero only if, you know, Tn equal to 1, which is class 1, right? So when you sum over all points, all right, all points, you will only get contributions, you will get the sum of the x's that are in class 1. So this is the empirical mean of the training points that are in class 1, and similarly, this is the empirical mean of the points in class 2. And of course, you can generalize this to capital K classes, and you'll get a similar result. All right, now we have derivatives with respect to capital sigma that, I remind you, is the same as before. I'm only going to highlight the proof, okay? And I'm going to highlight one trick that is almost universal when you work with this type of Gaussians and comes everywhere, so you need to know this trick, all right? It's not only here, but it's everywhere. So you can, when you take logs, right, this is where, in the log of this Gaussian and that Gaussian, where sigma is going to come, and the sigma is going to come through the determinant normalization factor, and then from the two exponentials, right? So two determinant terms and two exponentials. So I am going to tell you what the trick is, and the rest is basically renaming some variables. So I want you to concentrate on this transpose sigma inverse times that. What type of quantity is this whole thing when you see it like that? Like this transpose times this matrix times that. Is it a scalar? Is it a matrix? Is it a vector? What is it? So the exponential in the Gaussian. Scalar. All right. So let me tell you what the trick is. Okay? If it is a scalar, I can write this as the trace of the scalar. nothing changes, right? I pretend that this is like, you know, a matrix, but it's a scalar. So that this thing is equal to the trace of the same thing. Now, can somebody maybe knows if you have trace of A times B, how is it relates to trace of B times A? Say it again. They're equal, right? And I didn't say scalar in that case, right? It's general. So you know what? If you write this equal to the trace of the same thing, you can also write this as the trace of sigma minus 1 times this x when xn minus mu 1 transpose, which is a matrix, the two things together. Xx transpose is a matrix. So I can write this, again, as the trace of sigma minus 1 times this vector times that row vector that gives you a matrix. Can you see that? And what is, so you would basically get something that looks like this term here, xn minus mu 1, xn minus mu 1 transpose, okay? And if you actually scale this by dividing by n1, all right? And you look at that equation, what is S1? I mean, I define this to be S1. What is, with words, what's S1? Look at that. The empirical covariance of the points in class one, okay? So effectively, if you do the trick I describe on this term and that term, okay, and you just define S1 and S2 to be like that, and then define S to be like that. So just some scaling, multiply by N, divide by N, just to make things to look nice. It comes out that the terms that involve sigma, they take this wonderful form. Minus N over 2 times log of sigma. You can see here Tn log of sigma and Tn log of sigma, these two things will cancel, and you get summation of 1, which is N. So minus N over 2 log of the determinant, minus n over 2 trace of sigma minus 1 times this matrix S. All right, now I am not going to do any algebra because I am assuming that somebody somewhere, if not somebody somewhere, you have to do it on your own, you have to read the books. If you look at the maximum likelihood estimation for the covariance of a multivariate Gaussian, you will see that when you try, if somebody gives you data from a multivariate Gaussian and it tells you estimate the covariance matrix, the MLE estimate, before you do the optimization, it looks exactly like that, the likelihood. All right? And when you read, so when I mean exactly like that, it is exactly like that. And you know in that case of the multivariate Gaussian, what S is? Can you guess? I mean, the final answer is going to be basically that the MLE estimate of sigma is equal to this S. In the multivariate Gaussian, what is S? What is that S? What is the MLE estimate for the covariance for a Gaussian? For the mean, you told me it's the empirical mean. For the variance is what? What is the empirical mean for the, I mean, what's the MLE estimate for the covariance? We did the scalar case, actually, and, you know, but in another class, I will do the multivariate case. So what's the MLE estimate for the covariance? We have the empirical mean, and what, the only thing that makes sense is, say it, no average, the empirical covariance, okay? So you can see here, right, I defined the empirical covariance for class 1. For the multivariate Gaussian, it will be 1 over n summation over all points, x minus mu transpose. That's the empirical covariance. Okay? So in our case, the calculation leads to the same formula as for a multivariate Gaussian, but now the estimate for sigma, all right, so the MLE estimate for our classification problem is given by this formula. So it's basically a weighted average, if you like, of the two empirical covariances. Very nice answer. And you can generalize this result, actually, for many classes as well. Again, summary here, I want you to remember the trick. This thing, you should always write it as the trace of sigma inverse times the matrix X minus mu transpose, all right? Column vector times row vector gives you a matrix. So you write it like this, and with scaling, we got that. And then the MLE estimate when you take derivatives. If you don't, you know, if you don't know anything about the MLE estimate for the covariance of a Gaussian, you know, I invite you to go and take derivatives of these two terms with respect to sigma, and figure out things on your own with your own mathematics, right? So there is a determinant there. You're going to have to take derivatives, and there is this trace. You're going to have to take derivatives. So there's a lots of things to learn by taking derivatives with respect to sigma. All right? Now you may say taking derivatives of the determinant with respect to the matrix itself, what is that weird thing? Well, if you do it, you will know what it is. Okay? But so equations look simple, but you have to do them once or twice, right? Otherwise they will be looking, I'm sorry to say, they will be looking Chinese. The Chinese say they will be looking Greek, but you know, for Greeks they will look Chinese, okay? Unless you actually do the derivation. And if you don't do it once, you will not be able to repeat it actually in other problems because this comes again, right? The gradient of the log of the determinant, it's a very common type of derivative. Okay, done. And let me see if I finish with this. I think I did. And so now what I'm going to do is, because we are sort of running out of time and I try to zigzag in the lecture, I want to do something actually on the extreme now. I want to start talking about some Bayesian model of a non-Gaussian model. So I actually want to do logistic regression, and I want to tell you how actually you can generalize a logistic regression model to put a Bayesian framework to it. Can somebody remind me, what did we call logistic regression as of now? I really gave you only one formula. You don't really need a lot there. I didn't do any algebra with it, but what is logistic regression? So we have directly a discriminant function, right? So we write down the probability of X being in class C1 in which form? What was the model? There was only one equation. We said the probability of X being in C1 is equal to the sigmoid of W transpose X. You remember that? Right? And you know, I show you some pictures that the results look very nice. Didn't really do any algebra. Didn't do like any estimation of the parameters W may be using MLE. So now you know what I'm going to do is with nothing that I told you about the sigmoid except the formula, I want to take the remaining 20 minutes or so and actually do the whole Bayesian framework for logistic regression just to spice a little bit things and make it a little bit more complicated. To convince you that, you know, going from MLE estimates to a fully Bayesian framework, it takes some extra effort, okay? It's not, nothing is trivial. All right. So let me, I'm going to start the algebra, and so I want you to remember in your head, the model is the probability of C1 given X, all right, is the sigmoid of W transpose X. All right, so there is a W. So if we're going to do a Bayesian analysis, W is going to be a random variable, right? That's what the Bayesian analysis is. And if we're going to be Bayesian, what do we have to do the first step on W? If it's going to be a random variable. What do you do in Bayesian modeling? We don't find a prior, we assign a prior. Okay? I wish there was a methodology to find a prior, but there is no such a thing, so we assign a prior. So you know what? We know so little, you know, so let's say we're going to take a prior that it's a Gaussian, right? Because we can hopefully we can do calculations with Gaussians, and I'm going to take some mean M0 and some covariance matrix S0. So I'm going to write the posterior of w, because this is what we're going to have to compute, as the prior times the likelihood. All right? And remember, t is the labels, right? Okay? Is the probability of being class 1 or class 2, all right? So that's given w, I know that, right? Remember, what type of, what is, you know, so I can, you know, you can, we can communicate here. If I give you w, what's the equation for this probability? You told me 2 minutes ago. The sigmoid, okay? So if I know w, that's the sigmoid thing, because we stated directly to be the sigmoid. Okay, so I am going to write a likelihood equation in a very nice compact form the way we did before, okay? And I want you to, so yn, so first you have to tell me that you're comfortable with this, and then you have to tell me what's yn. And actually you have to tell me precisely what's the function, what's yn? Obviously it has to be a function of w, so what's yn here? Again? It's the sigmoid of w transpose xn, all right? W transpose xn. Everybody sees this, right? Because the model says, right, we stated that this, you know, if we know w, this probability, okay, in being class 1, is given by the sigmoid of w transpose x, okay? And 1 minus y will be of being in class 2, okay? And Pn takes the value 1 and 0, so you know if you're in class 1, you'll get y1. If you're in class 2, you will get 1 minus yn. All right, we have a prior, we have a likelihood, so I take the log posterior, so the log from the prior, the log from the likelihood, and this is my yn, so I have the posterior written down, okay? Now, I want you to appreciate that this equation, as easy as it looks like, it's complicated, right? Because this looks nice, right? I can see a quadratic form from the Gaussian, but this now yn here in the logs is log of the sigmoid function of w transpose x. It's very complicated to me, right? Because that's what you have. You have the log of the sigmoid function. Good luck. So we will not be able to do much calculations here. So somebody, for example, can say, will you be able to actually put this whole approximation, will you be able to actually find this posterior in some analytic form? The answer is no, there is no such a thing. So the posterior of w doesn't have any nice form. It's not a Gaussian. It's nobody knows. Numerically, we know, but there's no analytic form that fits in. So what are we going to do? We're going to use the Laplace approximation to fit this posterior. So I want somebody to remind me now, what is the Laplace approximation that I told you? It comes all the time when there's nothing else you can do. You always approximate the posterior with the Laplace approximation. What's the Laplace approximation? With words, I don't need equations. What's the Laplace approximation? We're gonna use a Gaussian, and that Gaussian is going to center. What is gonna be the mean of the Gaussian? What is going to be the mean of the Gaussian? The mode, so the map estimate. And what is going to be the, how is the curvature of the Gaussian at the map estimate going to be defined? It's going to be defined in such a way that the precision of that Gaussian, so the inverse variance, is going to be minus the second derivative of the log posterior. You remember that? If not, you have to go back, right, and see how you approximate any distribution with the Laplace approximation. You want basically the curvatures to match, right, around the mode estimate, okay? All right. By the way, just in case I have not mentioned this before, if you have a posterior distribution that is multimodal, right, there's one mode here, another mode there, you cannot really use the Laplace approximation. It just makes no sense because the Laplace approximation has only one mode, right? It's a Gaussian. So if you use the Laplace approximation in principle, you'll be fitting one of the modes, not the other. All right? So literally, when you do a Laplace approximation, the idea here is that you have a lot of data, so the posterior that somehow you compute there with a lot of data, it's sharp around one mode, okay? Otherwise, the Laplace approximation is garbage, okay? All right, so we're going to be able to compute this, we need to do two things, right? We need to find the map estimate, and then we need to find this second derivative of this log posterior. And, okay? So, I don't see the map estimate explicitly, but can you tell me what type of calculations you will need to do? So, taking derivatives with respect to W, right, it's not a big deal here on this term, right? So, for example, when I take this minus the second derivative, immediately you will get S0 minus 1. How do we take derivatives of log of y? What type of calculation do you have in mind? What's the remember, y is the sigmoid of w transpose xn. So what's the derivative then of log of y with respect to w? Let's do one derivative. How do you take the derivative of log? 1 over yn times the derivative of yn, that is the sigmoid function. And what is the derivative of the sigmoid function with respect to its argument? That's something you need to know all the time because it comes everywhere. So if I give you the sigmoid function, what's the derivative? And you can use the definition actually and differentiate it to see it. So the derivative is sigma times 1 minus sigma. So the derivative of the sigmoid function with a sigma, right, that's a Greek symbol, with respect to its argument is sigma times 1 minus sigma. So if you take 1 over y times sigma 1 minus sigma and then differentiate once more and you combine terms, you get this wonderful result that minus the second derivative of the log of the posterior comes with this wonderful formula. And you can actually take derivatives directly with respect to W to get the map estimate. And here are the answers, all right? I don't know why I missed the map estimate here to put the equation, but the answers, basically, you have explicitly a formula for the map estimate. You have an explicit formula for the covariance. This is, you know, the inverse of the covariance, but you basically have a ready-to-go Laplace approximation for the posterior distribution of W, okay? All right, so we have a Laplace approximation for the posterior, and so what type of calculations do we do in Bayesian models? What will be our interest to do here? So I computed the posterior of W, right, an approximation. What do Bayesian people do? You have to compute, you know, at the end of the day, the predictive distribution. So if I give you point X, right, you're going to have to tell me what's the probability being on this class or that class. And because it's 12:09, I only have 10 minutes, I am going to jump directly to that calculation. All right? Where are you? Here is my calculation. To calculate the again, don't be bothered that I use phi instead of x, right? I just want to generalize and say you can use some basis functions. But the predictive distribution is, given my training data, which is this bold t that you see there, and a test point x or phi, I want to know what's the probability of being in class 1. And that is the likelihood. And the likelihood is what function? What is the likelihood again? It's a sigmoid times the posterior, and the posterior we approximated with a Gaussian, all right? So now we're going to need to calculate the integral in W of the sigmoid, W transpose phi, times this Laplace approximation, this Gaussian Q of W, and that's our task. And you may say, how easy is actually to calculate the integral of the sigmoid function with a Gaussian? All right? Now, I may come and say to you, here is the answer, here's a beautiful formula, but because the sigmoid comes all the time in machine learning, right, being able to compute things that involve the convolution, if you like, of a sigmoid with a Gaussian, it's a task that I can tell you at least 10 cases that is coming in ready to go, and the algebra is always the same, okay? So how do you actually do this calculation of this integral of the sigmoid with Q of W? So I'm going to highlight this, okay? The proof is in the notes, okay? We only have 9 minutes left. So here's the idea. And it is sophisticated in the context of mathematics, okay? But not very complicated. So what I'm going to do is I am going to define A to be W transpose phi, just a new variable, all right? So A is equal to W transpose phi. So I'm going to start playing with two variables. In addition to W, I'm going to also have this new variable A. So W and A. So I am going to write sigma. You remember here I have the sigmoid of W transpose phi. I'm going to write this as this delta function, sigma of A dA. And will you agree with me with the definition of the sigma function that you're happy with that? All right? Okay. Now, I don't really care about this because this is what I care. So let me take an integral now. If I multiply this with Q of W times dW on both sides, all right? On the right-hand side, you know what? Because sigma, remember, there is an integral in A here. So if I multiply this with Q of W and I take another integral in W, I'm going to have two integrals, one in W and one in A. So if I change the order of integration, what I really need to compute, all right, what you really need to compute is the integral of sigma of A times some function P of A dA, where the function P of A is given by this integral that you see here, delta of alpha minus W transpose phi Q of W times dW. Again, if you ask me, where is this coming? It's coming simply by computing this and exchanging the integration in A with the integration in W and defining this integral in W to be P of A. Okay? Now you may say, what exactly has been accomplished here? And let me just tell you without going through the algebra, and maybe you can appreciate this. I want you to look look at this definition of P of A, all right? Look at the definition of P of A. Can you tell me, look at that integral, all right? So am I right to actually call that integral? So Q of W is a Gaussian, all right? Q of W is a Gaussian. What type of distribution you think P of A is? So look, I want you to, so Q of W is a Gaussian, and I have this delta function, an integral in W, okay? So when you have any distribution and you integrate in its argument, how do we call this operation in probability? I mean, if I have a Gaussian in variables x1 and x2 and I integrate in x1, how do you call that? What do? You marginalize. Here, I want you to look P of A as a marginal distribution of Q of W. But can you think why I call it a marginal distribution? What components of W have I marginalized? Because, you know, when I write this integral, I say, do the integration, but only consider the components W such that A equal to W transpose phi. Right? So if you think these components being, you know, on this plane, when I write this equation, I say marginalize in W, all right? Which W have I marginalized out? I mean, can you see that this is a marginal distribution in Q of W of a Gaussian? But it's not your typical one, right? It says, you know, keep only, because of the delta function, only the W such that A equal W transpose phi. So which W's you don't keep? I have a constraint that tells me what W to keep. So what W I don't keep? I'm indicating here's my W that I will keep, right, as a vector. Which W you don't keep? If you think of vector algebra, the W that is what? Is perpendicular to this constraint. All right, thinking as vectors. So here's the idea. This distribution, P of A, is a marginal of a Gaussian, the way I describe it. And why is that important? Because if it is a Gaussian, what do you need to describe a Gaussian? Only the mean and the variance. So effectively, we can actually compute the mean and the variance of P of A using the definitions of the mean and the variance. And the only thing you have to do is plug in what A is and interchange the order of integration of W and A. All right? And immediately you come up that the mean of A is W map transpose phi. All right? You can see here, eventually what you get when you interchange the integration in A and W, this is what you get. And I advise you to just go and do the algebra, right? Just go and plug in what P of A is in terms of W and integrate in A and leave everything out in terms of W. So you get Q of W, which is a Gaussian, times W transpose phi. So effectively what I see here is the mean or the map estimate of Q of W, right? So what you get is W transpose map phi, and then for the variance what you get is phi transpose SN phi, where SN is the covariance coming from the Laplace approximation. Bottom line is, right, that somehow once you do the Laplace approximation for the posterior of W, you can, and you introduce this new distribution P of A, all right? This new distribution P of A comes to be a Gaussian, all right? It's a marginal, basically, of Q of W, and that Gaussian has this mean and has this variance, and here is the answer. P of A basically is a Gaussian that has this mean, all right, and has this covariance, and actually, if you look very carefully on this, okay, it looks very similar to what we did for regression problems, except the fact in regression problems we had exactly the same predictive distribution, but there was this noise from the likelihood, beta minus 1 I. There's no noise here because the data don't come with noise, right? Either they're class 1 or they're class 0. Okay. Let me close this and say the following. So what we need to compute the predictive distribution is now an integral in A of sigma of A, so that's a sigmoid, times P of A, all right, okay, dA. And A, what is A again? I did not emphasize this clearly, right? So quantity is A. Is it a scalar, a vector, what is it? What's W transpose phi? It's a scalar, all right? It's a scalar. That's why, basically, we went through all this algebra. So the sigmoid function of A, okay, and now I have P of A that comes to be a univariate Gaussian, and Now that's where we are going to use the inverse probit function to approximate the sigmoid. So to be able to compute the predictive distribution analytically, you need to be able to compute the convolution of the sigmoid of a scalar variable times a univariate Gaussian. And then you need to integrate things out. Okay? It comes out, again, from this not very lengthy algebra, but rather sophisticated, that this predictive distribution, so if you want to a new point x to see what's the probability of being class C1, you have this integral in a scalar A that involves the inverse probit function that approximates the sigmoid of A times a univariate Gaussian with known mean invariants. And the question is now, does this integral exist analytically? And the answer is yes. And here is the formula, okay? So you see the formula on the bottom. This integral has an analytical form, and it is given, actually, let me see if there is another formula, right? So here's the answer, okay? So this is given by this coefficient k, and this coefficient k is a function of sigma squared, all right? That's the variance that we calculated, times the mean of that distribution A. Okay, mu A and sigma A come as the mean and the variance of P of A. So effectively, you have a closed form solution of the predictive distribution. So let me show you if there are some pictures. The predictive distribution looks very nice, okay? So the separating boundary is a straight line, but if you take contours of the predictive distribution, you can see that the further you are from the data, the further this posterior spreads. So this is a very nice way